Hey everybody, stay tuned where Rob and Brian are going to be taking me through how to pick the right landing zone for my organisation. So welcome to the Azure Enablement Show, where we're talking to Microsoft experts about some of the questions and obstacles that you might face on your cloud adoption journey. Now, in a previous episode, we touched on landing zones, which are great ways to enable you to deploy your cloud environments faster. But to dive in deeper and to allow us to talk about how you can actually pick the right landing zone, I'm welcoming back Brian to the show. Welcome, Brian.
Hey, sir. How you doing?
Awesome. We've also joined by Rob, who's a first timer on the show. So welcome to the show, Rob.
Oh, happy to be here. Thank you, Sarah.
Awesome. Now, in the last episode, we kind of touched on landing zones and we mentioned that there's different types. Brian, could you take me through what those types of landing zones are again, please?
Yeah, we talked in the last episode about how there are some landing zones that are great for starting small and expanding over time, and some that are really focused on starting with enterprise scale up front so that you can start with the controls that you need when you begin adoption. And I think we'll go a bit more into both of those in today's session.
Awesome. So I'm starting to think about how we could use these landing zones. And I'm remembering when I was a consultant and all the different organizations and IT departments that I spoke to, and they all have different operating models. You know, some had full control of their IT, others only had like regional control where they were governed by a more global kind of IT department. How does landing zones adapt to those different kind of operating models that we can see across our organizations?
That's a great question. And we'll talk about that in a little bit later in the session when we do a comparison side by side. But Rob, were you wanting to add to that one, sir?
Yeah, so I think what's really important is to quickly just talk about the implementation options that we have. And then you could kind of go from those implementation options to what your how you are actually organized in your environment to really help you out. So if you take a look, I've got a couple slides just to kind of help us out with this, to talk about this. Of course, from Microsoft itself, we have a couple different implementation options. We have the Start, Small, and Expand. We use our Azure Blueprints with ARM templates to go ahead and deploy your landing zone. And on the slide you see here on the left-hand side, I actually have an example here for you today of our CAF Migrate landing zone, where you would actually go ahead and deploy the resource groups. It would start you off with some basic things like storage, log analytics, put a key vault in there for you. And then of course your workload itself would actually show up in the resource group itself in that Azure virtual network. Then the other implementation option we have is the one we call Enterprise Scale. So with Enterprise Scale, it's also deployed using Azure Policy and ARM templates, but it's a little different. We don't use blueprints in that one. And as you could just see from the diagrams, right, Sarah, there's a big difference in what you get from the left to the right, depending on which approach you go with. And the thing to show you though, in the Enterprise Scale side, is that if I drill in a little bit here in this architectural diagram, the landing zone itself exists right here. And this is where your workloads themselves would go. All the other pieces of enterprise scale build you the foundation so you can actually stamp out multiple landing zones for all your critical line of business applications. And I wouldn't do justice if I didn't just quickly touch on our other implementation options using third parties. Like, we have implementation options that come from our partners, right? Our partners have been working with landing zones for a long time, and they have a bunch of different ones available through their services. And we have Terraform modules. So what you will find that if you go into the Terraform modules page and search for Cloud Adoption Framework, you will actually find modules not only to help you with the Start Small approach, but also with the Enterprise Scale approach. And by understanding those options up front and then mapping that to your operating model itself, like you asked in your question, this is how you can really figure out which is the best approach for you. Brian, do you want to take us through the operating models?
Yeah, I'd be really happy to. So we look at the operating models through the lens of four common models that we see across our customer base. So a lot of customers have decentralized operations where they're not trying to create shared services or bring things together. They're managing one workload at a time. But probably a larger share of our customer base focus on central operations. And this is more the environment where you do have those centralized teams for IT ops or IT security or whatever those roles may be, that they own production and they manage the workloads. Then there's also enterprise operations, which is where we're trying to drive customers to over time, where you can think about centralized operations and decentralized operations in more of a democratized state. Where some environments are stable state, they're steady, you don't have to do a whole lot, you can manage them centrally, but others you need that rich innovation capability that you would get with a decentralized model. And then we have some customers that are really trying to figure out, how do I bring all of these together? And they've got distributed operations where some data centers are centralized, others decentralized, and we're trying to help them find the right balance so that they can manage distributed ops across all their data centers. So each of these has a different degree of environmental complexity, and depending on which one of those best fits your needs, you may find a different implementation option that's a better fit for you.
Excellent. That certainly clears up the question about how you pick the landing zone and what you think about if you've got different operating models. Now, I'm also slightly worried that if I was in charge of picking a landing zone, I might pick the wrong one. Is it possible to actually pick the wrong one?
Yeah, it definitely is. If you choose an operating model, or if you choose a landing zone that fits a central operating model, but then you need to go enterprise, it can be a little bit difficult to make that transition. If you start with an enterprise operating model and really you don't need those centralized shared services, you may end up with a lot of extra overhead to manage that you didn't really need. So it's really important to pick the right one. And Rob, would you say the same, sir?
So, Brian, one of the things that I always bring up with my customers around, can you choose the wrong one? Or what is the impact to that? Because that can happen, right? You can take the wrong approach that doesn't work out. I tell them, I hate to see when a customer spends 3 or 4 months going down, say, one approach to building their foundations for their landing zones, and then realizing that the other approach would have been better for their particular organization. Maybe they didn't identify their operating model correctly. Maybe they thought they were in centralized operations, but really they wanted to get to enterprise operations and they should have just started on the other path. It would have put them there faster.
So the operating model is one of the decision makers for the landing zone, if I'm hearing you guys correct. Are there other decisions that could potentially impact your landing zones, like what level of Azure skilling your staff has, project lead times, budgetary requirements? Do they all feed into how you pick the landing zone as well?
Yeah, there's a lot of considerations there, Sarah, for when you select your landing zone. In fact, we have a slide that we commonly use because to help guide our customers or even partners when they're trying to decide what's the best option for them. And there's a bunch of considerations to think about when you go through this. Remember, we're not saying that one is better than the other. You just have to understand what's the right choice for your organization, depending on, like you said, your operating model and some other considerations as well. So first off, we did talk about the operating model and how you should understand which one fits you best. Are you centralized operations or enterprise operations? And sometimes it's not even which one fits you best, but also where do you want to be in 3, 6 months, a year, 18 months from now, right? And that may play into which approach you take and what makes the most sense. The other thing to think about is adoption plan considerations, right? Are you looking to do something that is, going to be long-term? Are you looking to do, what kind of velocity are you looking to drive within your organization? And are you looking to achieve operational excellence in the short-term or long-term? Brian, how would you say that start small really fits into that?
Thanks, Rob. Yeah, so if you start with the start small and expand approach, there are ways to get to those criteria of self-sufficiency, adoption velocity, and operational excellence. But the difference is that if you start small, it gets you started. Now you have to expand out on that landing zone model. So you would use things like the governance or the management methodologies inside the cloud adoption framework to iteratively build those pieces into the landing zone solution. Whereas enterprise scale takes a slightly different approach. Rob, you want to share a little bit about that approach?
Yeah, so what enterprise scale does, Brian, is it builds out that foundation for you, taking into account all the guardrails around security, identity, network, you know, even DevOps and automation from out of the gates. So it builds all that out for you, which is going to be, like we saw in that previous slide, right? A much more complex initial architecture that you're going to have. But the goal there is to put you on the right path using the same 8 areas of design that you would use in the start small and expand, but just kind of leapfrogging you through some of the iterative process to put you there at a little bit shorter amount of terms. Doesn't mean you're always ready to do that, though, from your organization, right? So again, you need to choose which one is best for you.
Yeah. And ultimately, I think that second sentence there summarizes it well. Are you trying to build your own solution over time? Or do you want to start with cloud native operations that are ready to go right away?
Right. Sarah, does that make sense to you so far?
Absolutely. Yeah.
All right. The other one that really comes into play a lot is around compliance considerations. So when you go to choose your landing zone, a lot of times, you know, especially when we get engaged, whether it's Microsoft, it's a partner that gets engaged with a customer, or the customer is just going out to the cloud adoption framework, right, and going through the different methodologies. They sometimes have time constraints over when they need to have a particular workload or application that needs to be compliant, right, in a short amount of time. So say, for example, I'm a customer that has to be PCI compliant over the next 8 to 10 weeks, right? That comes into play when we think around which landing zone to choose. Now, if they're relatively new to Azure, right, and they haven't built all the skills that they may need, they may think about, well, you know, enterprise scale can basically get them at a pretty high enough starting point where they may be able to get that secure compliant workload in time into their landing zone to meet their timelines. But it may not always work best for them. And especially when it comes down to, you know, around the skill set of the, you know, how comfortable are they in Azure, right, Brian?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And if we look at that from the other end of the spectrum, if they start small and expand, you would want to start with workloads that didn't have strong compliance requirements, maybe things that were low risk, low data sensitivity requirements, some of those less important workloads that you can move through and build those Azure skills over time, and add the governance and management methodologies as you understand how the cloud works. But not every company has a pool of low risk, non-mission critical workloads that they can just experiment with. So it really depends on what you're trying to accomplish from a compliance perspective.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, a lot of times once you've tried it out, you know, you've put, like you said, some pretty low risk applications in there, then a workload will come in and there's going to be regulatory or compliance requirements. And that's where you really follow the cloud adoption framework's govern and manage methodologies, right? To really expand that out and iterate on that initial start small landing zone to really grow it out to be comprehensive for your workloads.
Totally.
Awesome. Is that all the design considerations, or is there any more that I should be thinking about before I pick a landing zone?
Yeah, there's a few others. Deployment considerations is something that you should really take to heart when you go through this and how you want to go ahead and deploy and manage your environment, what makes sense for you. So first off, no matter if you start small or you use enterprise scale, they both come with templates and a portal-based experience. So if you're not comfortable yet with the infrastructure as code, that's absolutely okay. Using Start Small and Expand, we use Azure Blueprints, we use Azure Policy in there as well, and ARM templates. So all those things are inside the blueprint, and you could go ahead and follow through the portal and deploy that anytime that you need to. On enterprise scale, again, we've got a couple different deployments, and in a future session, I'll actually take you through how to deploy enterprise scale. So you can see it firsthand. So it just depends for you which one makes more sense for where you are.
Excellent. I think I certainly have a clear idea of how to pick the right landing zone for my organization now. So thank you so much for your time, Rob and Brian. I really do appreciate it. Now, some of the resources that can help you pick the right landing zones are going to be shared in the description box below. So make sure you check that out. And please stay tuned to the Azure Enablement Show for future episodes.